Okay, so in the last class we had looked at the self-pollination, right? This we had finished.
Yes, sir.
And then we were going to start with the advantages and disadvantages. Okay, so just let's quickly revise these three different types of self-pollination. Autogamy is the transfer of pollen grain from anther to stigma of the same flower. Gytonogamy, the transfer of pollen grain from one flower to another flower of this same plant on the stigma, and that is the gytonogamy. And cleistogamy was when the flower is closed and when the autogamy type of pollination happens, that is self anthers as well as self stigma. And because they are close to each other, they will undergo this cleistogamy. And cleisto, like I said, it means closed. So that's what happens in the closed form flower, that is in the bird stage. So, and these 2 points, that is, it usually happens in the bisexual flowers.
Sir, you got disconnected.
Dusha, I saw again the same thing. Sorry, I guess the internet is kind of very unstable for past 2 days here. Yeah, but whenever I get disconnected, please let me know. Otherwise, I will go on talking alone to myself. So the self-pollination that can occur in the bisexual flower, or it can also occur in the unisexual flower, but on the same plant. And most important condition for the self-pollination was the anther and stigma, they must mature at the same time. So that is why then only this self-pollination can occur. Now, the advantages of this procedure. Okay, I hope, yeah, now I should be audible.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
This Gaonwala network, no? Okay, let me share the screen again.
Sir, we are on the second point.
Yeah. Second point, I did not even start the advantages.
No, behind. We are on the first slide only. Explain.
Behind.
Let me just repeat it once more. I don't know what has been heard and what has not been heard. So, autogamy refers to the pollination, that is the transfer of anther to the stigma of the same flower. So, there is involvement of only one flower. Gytonogamy, it is the transfer of anther from one flower to the stigma of the another flower, but they all are on the same plant, and that is gytonogamy. And the third type we had quickly looked at was the when the flowers are close and they do not open at all, and the anther and stigma, they are close to each other, so they will ultimately pollinate each other. Again, this is a type of bisexual flower, so that is called as cleistogamy. Cleisto means closed, and gamy means, like I had said, marriage, or that ultimately means the gamete fusion. So that is the cleistogamy. Also, in case of self-pollination, it can happen in the bisexual flower because it has both the reproductive structure, male as well as female. Or it can also happen with the unisexual flower on the same plant. If it is a different plant, that will be called as cross-pollination. But if it is the same plant and different flowers, that will be still a self-pollination. And the most important condition for the pollination to happen was the anther and stigma, they must mature at the same time. So the maturation, if you remember, I had said there is a growth phase, that means they grow during the flower stage, and then they become receptive to the other gamete. That is what we call as maturation in terms of anther and stigma. Like we also become mature adult after we attain the puberty. It's something similar with the flowers as well, but they just have a very short span of time, and the maturation of this happens there. So these were, this is what we had looked at in the earlier class. Now coming to the self-pollination part. So what usually happens in the self-pollination is, in bisexual flower that happens, but if the anther and stigma, they mature at the same time. So this is the condition, right? So then and then only this can happen. So that is one advantage. And also the parental characters, they are preserved indefinitely. Parental character means whatever flower color, the seed shape, or the color of the seed, color of the pod, the length of the leaves, all of these are parental character. That means they will be passed down from one generation to other. And that is the way they will be preserved indefinitely. Now, why will they be preserved indefinitely? Because there is no cross-pollination happening. If it is only self-pollination happening, then the chance of any other genetic makeup being mixed with these particular genes is less. That is why self-pollination is good for maintaining the parental characters. No or less wastage of the pollen grain, because self-pollination does not have to travel a far distance, like with the wind or with the insects. It is on the same flower or on the same plant. So less pollen grains they are required, and ultimately there is less wastage. And even the small quantity of pollen will be sufficient. Flowers need not be large and showy. Now again, self-pollination does not happen with the any pollinating agents as such. Means, of course, it can happen with the pollinating agent as such, but it does not really required for that self-pollination to happen. What does that mean is, like, if the flower is bisexual, it does not need any insect or wind to transfer the anther to stigma. The anther can just fall off on the stigma because it's in the same flower, right? So that way, no insects or no wind is required. And that is the reason, if the insects are involved, then the flower has to be relatively large and they have to be brightly colored and so on. So that is not the case with the self-pollination. On contrary, cross-pollination will need that, because it is happening with the wind or especially with the insect. Wind again does not need showy flowers, but surely it needs large flower so that it can receive the more amount of pollen grains from the air. Then again, scent and nectar need not be produced. Same reason, because it is not happening with the insects, which is one of the attracting factor with the flower, that is the scent and nectar. And if it is not happening with the insect, these scent and nectar need not be produced as well. Also, it is very, very economical for the plant, as the nutrient material required for all these nectar, scent, or large petal, that is being large flower, or more pollen grain, it's saved. And that way, it is very economical process for the plant itself. Okay, does anyone have any question here? Or have you not understood something from these points? I guess this is probably again a very, self-explanatory points.
Yeah, sir.
Okay, then the disadvantage. The first disadvantage is weakening of the variety or species. Now, can someone explain this? What would be the weakening of the variety or species? Okay, yes, Neashish, go ahead.
Yeah, so what it means is that there wouldn't be many varieties of flowers, or there wouldn't be different species of flowers, because there would be, like, there would not be exchange between two different species. So it won't create a new species, right? It will just continue reproducing on the same species. So there wouldn't be a variety of species.
But what is weakening?
Weakening is basically there won't be much variety of species.
Okay. Yajnesh?
Yeah, sure. So I actually saw something about this. So basically, when two different flowers
not related. Okay, so there will be some weakening genes, right? Like disadvantageous genes, and some other flower might not have that. So when they two pollinate, the disadvantageous genes like mostly go away, and the better genes take place, right? Like that's what I think. And then the offspring will be a better version. But suppose if from the same flower, then they both will have like the same disadvantages, and the disadvantages will like add up after some time.
Okay. Anyone else wants to add anything to this? Vidushi or Namit or anyone else? Rishabh? Yes, Prakriti?
Yeah, sir, maybe it could be because of self-pollination, like continued self-pollination. There won't be much improvements in the offsprings of the next generation and stuff.
Right. Again, someone else has also raised hand. Who is it? Anirudh.
So basically what will happen is the quality of the, you know, sir, offsprings and everything will reduce because it is of the same plant. So enough nutrients wouldn't be able to surpass from the anther and stigma, and that is why like everything's quality will be lowered.
Okay, so good. Most of you have given like quite satisfactory answer here. But one more factor to in addition to this is, like you might mean the same way, but it just has to be put differently. So what happens is, let's say a particular variety of a plant. We can take, for example, jasmine plant or even a rose plant, right? And if it has a particular character which is not suitable for that plant to grow properly or have the flowers in abundance, or the flower color is kind of little dull, or any of such weakening factor, or any of such not so good factor with that particular part, right? Now, if the self-pollination is happening, then these characteristics, whether the flower not being produced in abundance, or flower color being dull, or plant having certain disease, genetic disease, these, all these things, they get carried over throughout the generation, right? And what we had said in the advantage, the parental characters, they are preserved indefinitely. And if it is going to be indefinite, that means that plant is not going to come out of that particular phase of having some bad characters because the self-pollination, right? So that is what is the main reason, that weakening of a variety or species. And if this is the case, then obviously that lineage of the plant or the whole generation, all the generations of that particular plant variety will ultimately go extinct. Not like a whole of the plant variety, until and unless all the plants, they have the same whatever genetic disease or whatever that bad character I mentioned. Bad as in, not bad as such, but something which is not useful for the plant and it is causing some harm. That way, and that is what is referring to weakening of variety. And now maybe I'll give one more analogy to this. Like for example, we have a common, what we say, like if a man has to marry a woman, right? We usually say that do not marry in the nearest relatives, right? And the reason for that is, like, let's say I am a boy and I am going to marry my immediate cousin, let's say my uncle's daughter, right? So whatever, that means my parent and her parent, rather my father and her father, they are immediate brothers, that is real brothers, what we call, right? And if I'm going to marry my cousin, then in that case, what will happen is my parents have given me half of their genome, right? My father and even her father would have given half of her genome. And let's say my grandfather, that is even her grandfather, which is a single person, if he had a particular genetic disorder, it would have been carried to our fathers in a half proportion, that is 50%. But when we will marry with each other, the chance of having that fusion again, like same like grandfather. So my 50% of gene from my father, her 50% of gene from her father, they will be like collectively, it will make 100% of our genome. And that might give again a faulty offspring. So if we produce a child, that will have certain bad genetic disorders. Bad in the sense, the offspring may or may not survive depending on what genetic disorder we are talking of. So that way, like, we should not marry within the immediate siblings or relatives. And these are the reasons, because the genetic disorders, they get carried across the generation. And the chance of having them reproduced becomes higher when we marry. So this is something similar. The pollen grains and the stigma of the same flower, that is like the immediate siblings. And if they are not marrying with each other, but if they are fusing with each other, the chance of producing the same genetic phenotype like their grandfather in this case, as in the parents' previous generation. So that generation is quite higher, and those characteristics, they get reproduced again. I hope this point is clear to everyone. Yeah. If there are any doubts, please feel free to ask. The second point is poor seed quality and give rise to, again, less vigorous offspring. Because again, the same thing. Because if there is certain fault, and that fault in the sense genetic makeup change, or the seed quality in the original parent itself was not so good, it was rather poor. So that will get carried over the time. And those seeds, they ultimately have less viability, or what we called as, these are less vigorous offspring. That means they may or may not survive like how the other seeds would survive normally. So that is the second point. Weaker or defective variety or breed cannot be eliminated. If the self-pollination keeps on happening, then these varieties, they will become very difficult to eliminate, because they will obviously spread across. They will produce seed, they will spread in the nearby region, and then they will keep growing. So that way, these varieties, they cannot be eliminated. And it does not yield new varieties. Most importantly, so no change in the genetic traits, so no improvement. Again, the same point discussed in a different perspective. Ideally, we have an assumption that a hybrid variety is better. Not always. What we call as a hybrid these days is a little different concept than the how naturally hybrids are prepared. So whatever hybrids that we know of, like for example grains and stuff, we know that these are hybrid grains, and these are artificially done. But in nature, if the hybrids are being formed, they may or may not have improved characteristics. And that way, it like even the self-pollinated plant, it does not lead to new varieties. And that way, then again, there are no changes in the genetic trait. So ultimately, no improvement. Yes, Yajnish, you have a question.
So won't self-pollinating species, like, won't evolution be hard to them? Because evolution requires different type of, like, different types of this thing, right? So
what is the question exactly? I didn't get it.
Yeah, so in self-pollinating flowers, how will they adapt to something or else? Maybe evolutionize.
You mean how will they improve, or?
Yeah, how will they improve?
So they cannot improve as such if they are always self-pollinating. And that is when the chance comes of their improvement when they cross-pollinate. Right, for example, there is a jasmine plant in my garden and there is a jasmine plant in the school garden, right? Now, if these are individually cross-pollinating, they will they may not improve at all. But let's say the jasmine plant from my garden has certain less abundance of flower. That is the characteristic. That means it has certain weaker characteristic. And while the jasmine plant from the school garden has abundance of flower. Now let's assume that they cross-pollinate. So obviously the genes from the school garden, which has more abundance of flower, if it is cross-pollinating, is something which has weak abundance or less abundance of flower, that is from my school, my garden, then if they are cross-pollinating, the offspring which will be produced, it will have more chance that it will also have more abundance of flower, right? So that way the characteristic gets improved with cross-pollination. If it is just self-pollination, it will never improve. It will remain the same.
And isn't it like without evolutionizing or adapting, won't they get extinct faster?
Yes. So the self-pollinated plant, they have higher chance to get extinct because if there is even a one weak characteristic of that particular species or variety, obviously it will ultimate that. And that is when the variety or the species itself can go extinct. So that is very much possible. Anyone else has any other question?
Sir, yeah, like right now you said if it has a weak characteristic, it can get extinct. Like what will be a weak characteristic?
Weak characteristic can be a genetic disorder, for example.
Ah, okay.
Like sudden fall of leaves or yellowing of the leaves, or let's say the chlorophyll is not being formed. Chlorophyll is like a protein molecule, right? And that protein molecule is ultimately coded with some genetic code. And if that genetic code has certain mutation, then that chlorophyll will not be synthesized properly. Ultimately, photosynthesis will not happen. Ultimately, again, the plant will not grow properly. It will not get sufficient nutrition. So these are just an example. And there can be like how we also have quite a few genetic disorder. Plants also have certain genetic disorders in them.
Okay, sir. Thanks.
And also, for example, in simplest cases, like we know of mutation, right? I assume you people have heard this terminology called mutation. As a human being, we undergo certain mutation due to the UV exposure or X-rays or the lifestyle and various other factors. Similarly, plants, they also experience the same. So they also undergo mutation. Now imagine in one particular variety of the plant in my garden, it has undergone that particular mutation. And if it is only self-pollinating, then that mutation, if it is harmful mutation, it will be carried over throughout the generation and at one point that variety will be lost. So these are just like few examples of these disadvantage of the self-pollination. Yes, Nilofer.
So bananas, what kind of pollination do bananas use?
What kind, you mean self or cross?
Yeah, the self-pollinated or pollinated.
So I would assume banana, see, in general, all the flowers, they can undergo self-pollination and they can also undergo cross-pollination. Depends on what are the factors which are involved. So for example, like for self-pollination to happen, it has to have that maturation of anther and stigma at the same time. So if that is the favorable condition, let's assume the same case in banana flower. If the stigma and anther, they are maturing at the same time, and if the anthers of the same flower is falling on those the stigma of the same flower, then obviously that is self-pollination. But if it is like a farmland and where you have more of the banana plant, let's say 100 of banana plants you have in that farmland, there the chance is equally higher of having cross pollination. So it depends what situation are these. But in general, if I have to generalize that question, then the self-pollination can happen as well as the cross-pollination can also happen, depending on what are the factors involved.
I just checked, like banana ka, if itself cross, both can happen, yes, but generally what happens, but it says that bananas, they are, the fruits are produced from the female ovaries only without the need of male pollen.
So that is what we call as parthenocarpy. That is one of the terminology. I guess you may or may not learn in this chapter, but surely it is there in class 10. So parthenocarpy is, like the gametes are being produced. The reproduction may or may not happen, but the proper course of the development of these male gametes, that is, let's say, for example, ovary, into the complete fruit, that happens. And that is what is called as parthenocarpy, and could be the case with the banana. I'm not too sure of that, if it really happens that way. But there are things like this, that without sexual reproduction as such, the fruit can be developed. Okay, anyone else has any other question? So let's move forward. Cross-pollination. So the self-pollination, I assume you are very clear. And cross-pollination, again, you know, it involves the transfer of pollen grain from anthers of one flower of one plant to the stigma of the flower of another plant of the same species, right? Means that plant can be located somewhere else. So there is involvement of two different plants altogether. Different plant, I mean, of the same species. That means rose plant located at location one and the rose plant located at location two, right? That way. But it has to be rose plant. It cannot be rose to jasmine or jasmine to mango or something like that. That is cross species. We are not talking of the cross species pollination. And like I said yesterday, it does not happen. Cross pollination in this, like across the species, does not happen. Within same species can happen, like mango to mango or guava to guava, rose to rose. That is what is cross pollination within the same species, but with different plants. Now, the advantage of the cross pollination is healthier offspring. And I guess this we already discussed how it creates healthier offspring, because the chance of having that particular genetic makeup being carried to the next generation is reduced to 50%. Right? Again, if I have to give example, one particular flower, in the male flower, if it has some weak characteristics, or it has, let's say, again, a weak characteristic of less abundance of flowers, that is less number of flowers being present on the plant. If that is the characteristic, then the chance of that male anther to take this particular characteristic in the genetic material becomes only 50% in the next generation, because rest of the 50% will be coming from the female gamete, that is the ovule of the another flower. So that way, the healthier offsprings, they are being produced in the cross pollination. Abundant and viable seeds are produced. The number of seeds that are produced and the viability of those seeds is quite high. That means these seeds which are produced by cross pollination is quite a lot. That means they can grow in any circumstances. So that way the viability is much higher than the self pollination. And the third and most important point is new varieties may be produced by cross pollination of two different varieties or even two species. Like for example, pomato. We know that particular species, pomato, that is mixture of potato and tomato, that is, but that is artificial hybridization done with cross-pollination technique, but it is artificial hybridization. That means a human interference is required. Again, unstable. I hope I'm still audible.
So maybe you could switch off your videos, so it would be better.
Okay, let me try that. Where is video? Okay. These new varieties, it can be produced, which was the disadvantage of self-pollination, becomes an advantage of the cross-pollination because of the healthier offspring, more viability of the seeds. And also there is a mixing of genetic traits, right? One particular jasmine may have a little bigger petals, and the other particular jasmine plant may have more sturdy plant. That means its stem is thicker. And let's say these two characteristics get fused with each other during cross-pollination, because the flower of the sturdy plant pollinating with the flower of the bigger petal jasmine. And if these are cross-pollinating, then obviously those offsprings will have bigger petals as well as sturdy stems or better structure. So these two characteristics, this becomes like a new variety. And that way, cross-pollination can also generate healthier offspring in different varieties. Yes, someone has a question again. Yajnesh, I guess, or who is it?
Yeah, sir. So okay. Will the cross-pollinating flowers, pollen grains, will they have specialized structures to stick on the legs of bees or else?
No, they do not have specialized structure, but they surely have a little different genetic makeup. Like I said, one flower is mutated and the other flower is completely with all the good characteristics. Big flowers, many flowers, the stem is very good, the chlorophyll is very good. All of these are good character. And let's say if they are fusing, the chance is 50%. But if there are two varieties of the same plant, which has all good characteristics, and if they are cross-pollinating, their genetics material is getting mixed up, right? And that is the way they will be able to produce the better variety. Does that answer your question, Yajnish? I kind of forgot the question.
Yeah, sir.
Okay, so these are the advantages. Now, disadvantages of cross-pollination. Now, this pollination is always dependent on the external factors, and so it is not always certain. So let's assume for some random reason, the insects, they are not present in lot amount. And if that pollination is insect dependent, then the cross-pollination will not happen. Or let's say the wind does not blow much, right? Usually it happens some days, especially in summer, there is very less of wind around us. So then again, the pollen grains will not be transferred to different places. So these are the factors which are involved in cross-pollination. And if there is absence of these external factors, then the pollination may or may not happen, or it will happen to a lesser extent. Had it been the self-pollination, it will happen irrespective of any of these external factors. So that is one of the disadvantages of cross-pollination. Again, wastage of pollen due to large quantities of pollen, they are required. Now, why wastage? Because let's assume an insect is sitting on one of the flower, and the pollen grains, they are sticking to the body of this insect, and then it is carrying to the another plant. Now that particular flower where it is getting carried might need two or three pollen grains, but how much insect is carrying is actually getting waste, or insect does not even go and sit on the plants of the same species. Let's say from rose it goes to jasmine, it goes to then marigold and so on. Then the pollen grains will get deposited on all the unnecessary flowers. So that way, there is a lot of wastage of pollen due to the large quantity of the pollen grain that is required. And also it is uneconomical for the plant, because then the flower has to produce, it has to be large flower if it is pollinating with the wind, so that it can trap all the pollen grain through the air. Trap in the sense they should be falling on more surface area, more pollen grains will be received. So that is the idea. Or they have to be colored, they have to be scented, or they have to produce nectar. All these factors when they are insect pollinated, so that the insect can get attracted towards this flower. So this is required, and that way it becomes very uneconomical for the plant to have the cross pollination. So these are the disadvantages. Again, any question, anyone? With the, so here I have just mentioned the difference between self and cross pollination, but that you can go on your own. I will not do this in the class, because this, all these points we have already discussed in much detail. I guess I will stop here for today. In the next class, we will start with this. Nature will favor the cross pollination, and why does it do so? And there are again quite a few terminologies that you will get to know in the next class. Yeah. So let's stop here. If there are any questions, I can take it.